Okay. Hello, everyone. It's like we're starting over again. My name is Lynette Young, and you are now currently watching a Google Plus Live Hangout on Air, so thanks, everyone, for joining us. You can find me at lynetteyoung.com or search for Lynette Young on Google Plus, and that's how you'd be able to find me. I also run a community sort of online movement idea called Women of Google Plus, and you can find out more about that on Google Plus as well. Just search for Women of Google Plus. Self-explanatory. So tonight, our conversation is going to be about online communities and online community management. And thankfully, Valeria decided to come and help me out, and she is the best expert I could think of when it comes to online communications, conversations, and community building, brand building. She's just amazing. But Valeria jumped in with us tonight because our originally scheduled guest, Debning, had an emergency that she had to take care of and couldn't make it. So Valeria was an amazing friend and decided to jump in, so we all get to pick her brain right now, so I'm very excited. So Valeria, I'm sure everybody honestly probably knows who you are. But for the people, because we have a very, very large international audience, I would love for you to introduce yourself, and that'll help bring us a little bit into our conversation tonight about online communities.
Awesome. So thank you so much, Lynn, for having me here. I'm Valeria Maltoni. I'm the conversation agent, for those of you who read my blog. So conversationagent.com, that's where you can find me, or valeriamaltoni.com, and that's valeriamaltoni. And that's also my Google Plus identity, although I do have a conversation agent page on Google Plus. One of my claims to fame, quote unquote, because I don't take myself too seriously, many years ago, Fast Company kind of made available on their website space for people to get together, and we were basically doing hangouts with each other on a listserv. Yes, I know, I'm dating myself. And so that's how I got involved with community. I kind of fell into it. The thing is, I was really born into it. It was made in Italy. But here in the States, I fell into it through Fast Company. So that's my claim to community fame.
Oh, it's much longer than that. I mean, you've been, I mean, that may be the first place. I mean, because that's where I had first heard of you. But, you know, you've done so much more. But since we are talking about communities today, can you let us know a little more about how it kind of started up? Was it something that happened organically with Fast Company? Did they specifically look to grow a community, or did it happen by accident?
I think it was a combination of things. I started reading the magazine from the first issue, and I thought, wow, there's some people who are getting that work is personal, computing is social, and all that good stuff. Of course, I grew up in a very socialist area back in Italy, and so we did a lot of community building in schools and with our neighborhood, and a lot of the activities after school, and so I was kind of used to the idea. And so Fast Company found, it was specifically Heath Rowe, it was one of the editors there at the magazine, he found that people started emailing him to so that he could connect them with other people who were reading the magazine because they wanted to talk about the articles. And so Heath started this list, and soon the list became 1,000 people. And he, to his credit, he figured out, I'm not going to be able to keep up with this. So they found space on their website. They put aside some space, and he said, hey, here's some space that if you'd like, you know, raise your hand, and if you'd like, you could become the catalyst for conversations in your hometown and claim your city, kind of the Wild West, right? Go claim your city and invite people. And so, and then Fast Company, us, will point people to that. And so that's how it started. And it was, you know, a listserv on a .com site. And it had its issues. Sometimes the volume, you know, all the issues that you would experience on a regular network. Every network Twitter, right? Too much volume, too much traffic. And in the beginning, it was very much using the listserv to invite people offline. So using the listserv as a distribution place where people could figure out, okay, we're meeting in the back of somebody's store or in somebody's spare office conference room and stealing space after work or whenever to just meet some people or just have coffee with somebody and say, hey, I've read that story too, you read that story, and get together. And so our first get together was 4 people. And some of our last get-togethers were 200 people.
Oh, wow.
And so this is pre-Twitter. So the group at some point counted 500-plus members. Again, this is pre-Twitter. We didn't have Twitter. So we got creative. And so we started asking each other what other lists we were on, because lists are really important to get the word out, right? And so we went on the HR list, the marketing list, the communication list, and because we were a free network, we never charged for events. Mm-hmm. And it was our time and our resources. Everybody was happy to let us market our events on their lists. And so soon we got a cross-section of people coming. And then we started using the listserv more. It was kind of my pre-blogging before blogging. And we got in some heated discussions there too, which was interesting. So it was organic. It was a desire to talk about the topics of the magazine. Some of the things many people have experienced in their local community, or if they are part of an association, a lot of it happens because people say, hey, wouldn't it be neat to have a venue or a vehicle to talk about the things that we are all passionate about? I'm very systems-oriented and process-oriented, so I was more like the company than the friends. The network was called the Company of Friends. And so I started creating series of events and content and giving people expectations and raising the stakes and doing all kinds of stuff. But it was fantastic. It was a great experience.
So I'm glad to actually hear that from your end. One thing that you just said that kind of clicked in my head is that you felt like you were more the company than the friends.
Yes.
That's something that I've seen in online spaces, online communities, or a place where people are given a space to communicate freely. If there's no structure or loose set of rules or expectations, it's like it feels like bumper cars to me. So really what you're describing is, to some degree, is a community manager, because it's their job to figure out, one, with what the company themselves needs to put in and get out of the community, and what the community wants, because if they don't get it, they'll leave. So maybe you can talk a little bit about what you found, maybe things that resonated with people or things that were suggested or that other people tried to implement that, you know, you got pushback from. Just that kind of
experience. So in the beginning, we tried to be democratic, which is
not gonna work.
A big learning point for community managers. Don't try to be democratic. Be a good listener, and then with soft ears, and then decide direction and help people, facilitate people's ideas. Because what happens, it became very dispersive. So we were having events all over the city, and we were trying to be all-inclusive. So it was in the city or in the suburbs. I don't know if you're familiar with the Philadelphia area, but there are rivers. And so there is only one way out and in of the city, basically. And there isn't a lot of commingling because people have jobs and lives, and so it's hard to go back and forth, traffic and everything else. So I started observing that when we were having events in the city, although the events were well attended, there was a big part of the community that was cut out. And so we started experimenting with the frequency of the events. Our events were monthly. That's the company part of things. Was starting setting expectations. Every X day of the month, I forgot when it was, because it's been a couple of years since we didn't do it. We stopped doing it. And so setting expectations, then sending out the notes, you know, having enough time to promote the content, to give people advance notice so that they can book their calendars. And then we started experimenting which months were better in the city, which months were better out in the suburbs. And then we had them in the suburbs. The challenge was to find spaces that would be free, because we didn't charge for the events. And so I love community, but I wasn't going to be out of pocket every month for, you know, not knowing. Especially the challenge was also knowing how many people would show up. So some of the challenges, some of the operational things that I did on the company side as a community manager and troublemaker was figure out what those levers are that will allow us to have a good experience, or as good as an experience that we can have. So it was making the event, setting the expectations, predictability of some of the venues so that people would feel comfortable. Because there is a certain sense of when you're going out of your routine, if at least you're entering a new routine, it feels more comfortable. It feels you could meet new people, but then if the place is the same, so, you know, kind of navigating that. Finding free venues, so that was so finding sponsors, and then finding great content. I've always been a very strong advocate for great conversations, great content. Bring the people who are doing the stuff, they're making the stuff happen, to the conversation. And my other bias was get people to look behind the curtain. So it was the Wizard of Oz, but it was we know what's going on. Mm-hmm. Because to make some of the stuff happen, it was, you know, sometimes it was beg, borrow, and steal and make promises, and we always want to keep our promises. And so the predictability of the time, we decided the evening was the best time for everybody, and we picked a time that was better for most. So you can't always please everybody. Mm-hmm. And then we try to plan ahead of time, at least 3 months ahead of time. And the other thing, too, find volunteers. Find people who will support pieces of the process. So go out, and often they're very active or very passionate members of the community. And they either flag themselves or you help them a little bit by saying, well, I noticed that you're really keen on this kind of thing, and bring them to the fore. And I took the time to meet with them individually as groups. One of the things that I did, at some point for a couple of years, we had 9 volunteers who managed different pieces. We had meetups for the volunteers. And so I gave back to the volunteers by teaching them something or sharing resources, or sometimes Fast Company would send me their galley books that they got for review. I would get these boxes, so I would be like Father Christmas and bring, you know, all of the books to the meetings, and we would have coffee and take care of each other. It was the networking on top of the networking, and making sure that we were all happy and that it was working for us, because we were supporting the larger community. So that was also something that was very helpful. And then understanding where you could get the connections for the content and working with the content to attract the right people. But I can stop here because I know I've thrown a lot of stuff out there.
Oh, that's okay. Because, you know, people are watching later on, too. They can always pause and kind of
and
go
say,
back
wait
to
a moment.
It.
Let me take that note.
Let me think about that for a minute. So I'm curious to talk to you about the idea of, and you made the point of how certain people flag themselves with wanting to help, or maybe rising above the rest with talent or expertise or the ability to or the desire to want to volunteer and stuff like that. Is there any kind of tips that maybe you can give if someone is looking to find those people in their own communities?
Well, the first thing is ask. So I did, in the beginning, there wasn't a lot of online discussion because it was the early days. You know,
Yeah.
people were not used to, and this was more mainstream. It wasn't the techies or it wasn't the early adopters. This was just our friends and colleagues. And so, but I would do these emails through the listserv to, in between meetings, to keep people updated on what was going on, how many members were joining, and also to say, hey, this month we could do these things. This is what we need. Do you know somebody who does so and so? And that got some nice conversations going online. And so having those conversations, stabilizing the information in our community place, in our hub, helped also the people who could, you know, were at work and couldn't get on. I know it's 2012, but we still have that. And they could go on and check on later. And it was almost like a forum, right? In that format where you would have all of these links. And I tried to make my titles to the links very explicit so that people would know I'm clicking on this and this is the kind of content that I'm going to find. And I would have this email where I would go, you know, things that we need or big ask of the community, do you know somebody who does so and so, or are you interested in, and then sometimes people would, the one tip that I have is people are very hesitant to step forward because although they may not tell you, they know that you're doing a lot of work as the community manager and facilitator. So they're like, more power to you, I don't have the time. And so the tip here is break things down in a way that works for everybody. So if somebody is, you know, some professional associations do that a little bit, but I was kind of making it up. And so I was thinking, well, we are remaking the rules, and so we might as well make them to our image and what works for us. And so people would come to me and say, well, I could do that only 6 months out of a year. And so we would figure, it's almost like you have two temps, right? You would find another person, the yin and yang, and they would work together. And so understanding those limits and those ways that people wanted to contribute, but they couldn't contribute so much more, was very helpful for everybody. It kept things very healthy. And then I always made sure that people understood and knew that they could come to me at any time and say, "Time out. I can't do this. You know, I have stuff happening." But the deal was not at the last minute. Don't be a no-show. Don't be a bailout. Give us the chance to reabsorb whatever it is that you were doing. And generally, us was me, honestly. But it's, you know, that's like the manager, right? It's the manager part of community. It's whatever nobody else is doing, you pick it up because you're helping the community thrive. And then, you know, we would put it out there. You know, sometimes we would use the live event to explain, you know, so and so couldn't be here like tonight. And we found a replacement or we found another way of doing this. And it's about being sincere and being open and letting people jump in. That was my lesson. Because I am so process and systems oriented and I am such a workaholic, it was really hard. The hardest thing for me actually was to step back and let others own their roles and come into them. And in the beginning, it was also important for me to let them figure some stuff out without too heavy-handed coaching. So I was fortunate because we had a coach on the volunteer team, and we had a we need to have a coach moment conversation once. So that was fabulous because it set me right. Because sometimes we do things we try to be helpful and we're not. So we had that conversation and she was very helpful. So that's the other thing that that I did that was deliberate on my part. I looked for people who were unlike me to be part of the volunteering team. Obviously, we took everybody, but the more diverse, the better for the group. Mm. And so we had different backgrounds, we had different career paths. We had the one a great thing for everybody listening or anybody who is involved in community management, you have this amazing opportunity to help people either find or strengthen their path. One of the things, the outcome of when we had the large group of volunteers and all of the activities that we did to play with the volunteers as well, 4 of them out of 9 changed careers that year. And they were able to do that because they had the support of the community, but they also had, so there was a place where they could share what they were going through, but they also had the ability to test where they wanted to go by using those skills in supporting the community. So that was amazing.
Yeah, and part of the reason for the community in the first place, I would hope.
Yes.
So one of the things that I want to ask you, and this will deviate from online communities or communities in general, is because I know you're very much known as and it's the name of your blog and your company is The Conversation Agent. I want to know why, because it does. Online communities exist because, or offline, it doesn't matter. Communities exist because people want to have conversations with each other.
Yes.
And community managers, part of their role is to facilitate that conversation.
Yes.
And you are the conversation agent. And I want to know why it's important, and I want to know some of your more recent ideas and some of your philosophies on the state of communications and conversations online today, because it's all evolving. We see that now. Well, 6 months ago we did, but last year at this point we didn't have Google+. We didn't have another outlet for conversations. We didn't have another group of people to become exposed to or to find out and seek more information from. So it's evolving again. Rumor has it MySpace is back on the upswing, so who the hell knows? I mean,
you!
Who knows? But, you know, what's old is new again. But, you know, some things, the basics of it, the core of the communication and the conversations back and forth between people, that will never change, even though the tools and the platforms that we have online do. So I'm kind of curious on what your take on it all is now.
So it's interesting because this always comes up. Conversation is a word that we have drilled and into the center of the earth, I think, by now. See Clue Trade Manifesto and join the conversation and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I kind of didn't know about those things when I called my blog and my site Conversation Agent and my company. It actually comes from, I am from a family of all women, and we were always talking all at the same time. And which is what made me a great simultaneous interpreter, by the way, because I can hold several conversations in my head and just process the whole thing. And then I was made in Italy, another data point. All of our education, most of our education is based on oral testing. oral conversation. And so it's being able to hold a thesis and prove it and take people through it with stories and with supporting facts orally in front of your peers, in front of the professors at exams, during class, during the school year. In fact, my technique was to volunteer. The first 3 months I was volunteering every time they were taking names and they were asking to, you know, talk about such a matter that we needed to report on, because I spent the rest studying broader and the things that I was interested in. So they were tired of me by month three. It's like, no, I don't want to talk to you again. And so I've learned in university, actually, I was aware of this. I learned to use conversation as a tool to tease out ideas and to go from the place where we start, which we all come with our assumptions and thesis and knowledge, to a new place where we let the ideas that are discussed and the content, the knowledge that is being shared, inform our thinking. And so that's why my tagline also says, connecting ideas and people, how talk can change our lives, because it's literally a construct that you use to move people from one place, which is I come into the conversation, you know, with all of the stuff that I am, into a new place together. And the role of the community manager is, in fact, to help tease out the threads from the community and bubble up the knowledge and kind of playing back to the community, help facilitate the conversation in a way that you tease out the knowledge that people have and you help make those connections. And hopefully, by doing that, the community goes to a new place together. And so it's a way of evolving. You know, when we talk neurologically, I worked with neurological development, we change our brains, literally. Sometimes we're also willing to change our minds. So that's the conversation part. The agent is all about doing, because I thought about it, and the talking is really one way of deconstructing the information in a way that allows us to reconstruct it so that it's more useful to us. I don't know if you're familiar, and this has emerged to me by somebody who attended our workshop in Kansas City last week or the week before. Those images where you have two images, really. One is hidden inside the other, and you're looking at the image and you see one. But then once somebody tells you, or once you train yourself to see the other, you cannot unsee it anymore. And so it's the talking for so that we can see the other, whatever it is, that, and become more creative. And that's the construct that I use in business as well, to help businesses really going back to get back to basics. What are my assets? And in the community, right, what are my assets, what are my tools, what are the things that I am playing with, what am I trading, right, and what promises are we making so that we can keep making better promises, so that people have confidence that this community will be here tomorrow, that I can set aside the time every month to come out, and I'm investing my time in the community so that not only I get a personal return on that investment by learning and by connecting, but also by giving and sharing what I know and, you know, making the community richer. So that's you know, basically the idea behind. In fact, at some point I wrote a post, more agent, a little less conversation, because there's this misunderstanding that conversation equals talking. And conversation is really the construct. It's the context that you build so that ideas can make connections and people can make connections. And so, you know, it's kind of, maybe it was a little bit long-winded and brainy.
No, that's fine. That's fine. You know, it's funny because we've been talking about community together as far as the people that are part of the community. The part that is brought up to light more often now, and I know that you have amazing thoughts on this, is how brands and companies, but I'll use the term brands in a general sense,
yeah,
online, their role in communities, when they build them, when they become a part of an existing community, how do you see the whole corporate side of things fitting into it? Because communities bubble up for every reason under the sun, and then some that don't even belong to be communities. Just because people want to band together to have conversations,
sure,
about common interests or common,
yep,
features about themselves for whatever reason. Maybe, I don't know. I actually follow a Tumblr group that blog that's all about gingers, all about people that have red hair. And it's just, you know, it's like,
awesome.
Okay, this is how they decided to come together as a community, whatever. But they have great conversations and they share great info. But when brands and when companies have a monetary interest in communities, how does that shift how communities function?
So the other, you know, well-kept secret is that conversation agent is about trading business. It's not about, so community is a thing that we do as humans, and it's a natural thing that we do, but my construct is about trading assets and making the best possible promises. So I have been sharing in my talks a new definition of branding, or a definition of branding that I feel is closer to what a brand is, which is the sum of promises made, promises kept, and the unbounded expectations market. And the unbounded expectations market is very, very important to this conversation around community and business. Because business already has natural communities. If you have employees, that's your first community. And one often overlooked. I noticed recently Hugh McLeod coined a new term, or used a term in talking about what happens inside an organization, culture jamming. And, right? And
yeah,
so there is this undercurrent, call it what you will, the cooler, you know, by the cooler, you know, kind of conversations or the networks. I was notorious for getting in trouble whenever I got into an organization. The first three people I met were, the first was the corporate lawyer, corporate counsel, always take the corporate counsel out to lunch, and do pick their brain, because you're working for the same company, it's okay, everybody's getting paid, and figure out how they work, what their style is, because they can be either your biggest advocate or the biggest,
yeah,
tension, source of tension. And so, and you were talking earlier about communications, and I feel communications is a big piece of this. And communication, I see conversation also as a tool to negotiate meaning. So to negotiate how we're trading differently. So corporate legal are trading in a certain way, and employees, depending on where they're sitting and depending on their level of awareness, they're trading different skills, different skill sets. And absolutely, employees are assets, not resources. Let's not confuse. Let's use the proper language and semantics. They are assets because you trade relationships, and so you trade people as well. Teams, sports teams, it's okay for sports teams to trade people. Why isn't it okay for you to trade your team inside corporate America? It should be. It's not a bad word. It's okay. Asset is good. Assets make money.
Yes.
And so that's where the money and the brands and the community come together. It's trading promises. And it's building that confidence. Let's forget the word trust. The word trust is a white rabbit. We're not going anywhere with that. Let's use confidence, because when I can rely on you, Lynette, and I know that you keep your word, and I know that you will deliver promises made, promises kept, right, then I have confidence in you. And so I will stake my reputation, my credibility, my funds, my money in doing business with you, in trading with you. And so we're trading relationships, we're trading on reputations, that's also part of trading relationships, and we're trading our skills, our, you know, our assets. In some cases, in a service economy, we trade services. We trade, you know, picking up the phone and being customer oriented and all that kind of stuff. So there is this, so you cannot divide, you know, here's the brands on the one side, here's the corporation, here's the people. Because once you break it all down and you deconstruct it, it's all assets that can be combined creatively to trade. And so go back to the guilds of the Middle Ages, and go back to the masters and the, you know, now we're going back to the idea of craftsmanship, of becoming really, really good and mastering one domain, right? And we see that in technology, we see that in, we're starting to see that in a lot of entrepreneurial businesses, because it's getting back to making stuff gives us more things that we can trade. And so brands and money is really not the issue. The issue is a cultural issue. It's seeing the rabbit or the duck in that image, right? And focusing on the right image. And right now we're focusing on ducks, and we need to focus on the rabbit. It's just a stupid example, but... So once you do that, then you see your communities, you acknowledge them, you embrace them, and you negotiate meaning with them. And you negotiate meaning, you know, finding your path to sustainable trade.
You are so brilliant. because you know why? Because you take a much different look at things. I'd have to say you take a simultaneous granular and high-level view, but you look at things, I think, more holistically.
Yeah.
Of how they're going to affect multiple entities, and how it's just not one piece that moves. It's one piece that moves and everything else slams out of place. That's what I've always gotten from your content online, conversations, talks I've seen you in. I'm so glad that I was able to get you onto the,
yes,
this thing is, the hangout.
This is fun.
So I guess one thing I wanted to kind of end with is, well, I want to know what you're up to lately, because I know you have workshops, and I want to hear more about your workshops. So I'll ask you that part first. So what are your workshops? What are you doing? You're like all over the place.
So, that was actually a kind of a courageous thing for me to do, to go out there and say, I'm going to do a conversation agent workshop. Not because I don't have the ability to deliver. I always make a promise when I can deliver it, and so I can make a better promise next time. I was thinking, well, everybody's got their workshop. There is so many events, so many conferences, so many things that people can go to. And I also take myself to task. A little while back, I did a post where I talked about the seven shoulds of conference or event organizers, where I talk about the cultural underpinnings of American culture, which are very different from European culture. And this is from work from the Center for Cultural Studies and Analysis in Philadelphia. If you're interested, it's culturalanalysis.com, their site. They have some pretty, they have a chart. That is a map of ages and our group behavior. And so you can go find your age and find your characteristics, and you'll see it's pretty accurate. They put a lot of work into that. But they're cultural anthropologists, and they specifically study group behavior. And my culture that I come from is very much group-based. I talked a few moments ago about how we did exams with a class. And in fact, from 7th to 9th grade, we were graded only on group work. So all of our work was done in a rotation arranged by the teachers. Every month we would work with a different group of people, and we would have different roles We rotate roles. So we will be the researcher, the presenter, we would be the, I don't know, the scribe, and all of our grading was based upon the group, the work that we delivered as a group and not individually. And so that's the culture I come from. But the U.S. is very different. The U.S. measures everything, number one. Think about sports, right? Football, Super Bowl. Every inch is accounted for. You always know where you are on the field. Look at football, European football, soccer, right? It was a great effort that you put in. You lost the game, but great job, right? You lose the game here, you're done. Nobody talks about you. You're done. You're buried.
Yes.
And throughout the game, everybody keeps score. Mm-hmm. So and this is non-judgmental. It's different. And it's very individual. Culture here is very individual. It's based upon the pioneering spirit, the individual ability to make it. Think about cartoons, the superheroes, right? They're all coming back because we're in a moment of crisis, and now we need to rally. We need to find the superhero inside. Well, I have good news for you. We have superheroes. I have even better news. They are in the community. They are by working together. They are not by working alone. Mm-hmm. So each one of us has tons of superpowers. We may not see through buildings, we may not be able to, but we have those superpowers. And it's when we pull them together that we are so much smarter and that stuff just happens. It happens to us individually, it happens to us as a group. So how can I bring this experience to a group of very hard-nosed business people who are constantly measuring every yard in the football field, who are thinking about me first? And again, hey, that's great, because that's what brought us here. It's not what's going to bring us to the next level. Not in business, mm-hmm. and not in the economy, not in our communities. We need to go back to our communities and honor them. And so the idea is to use all of that I know and use myself as a facilitator and help the room do and think together. And so I'm keeping the group small. I am accepting up to 50. I think I put 60 seats because I was optimistic that day. And we're going to have other people in the room, obviously. And we have CEOs of companies. Now, these are people who have, in some cases, busted myths and defeated the odds to get where they are. And they have very compatible philosophies to mine. That was my criterion. I want to work with people who have a compatible philosophy, because no matter where they're coming from, what age they are, or what knowledge they have, I want to create this space, this environment, this context where people can play off each other's strengths and learn by doing. Because when you're involved, I have this thing about we love sharing online, and you know, I just wrote it down. We like to share because we like to brag, we like to complain. Right? Mm-hmm. Who doesn't like to complain? I have a whole post about how to complain to customer service. And we like to reach out, because we're social. Mm-hmm. We're social beings. And so we like to share, we like to search, and we like to discover things. So if here's a secret for PR people. Don't pitch. Let me discover you. Be like, ooh, you know, see-through, but not quite see-through. Mm-hmm. That works so much better for people when they think that they found it themselves. They found the content themselves. Because now they make their own. It's almost like help your boss succeed by thinking they came up with all the ideas, right? Yeah. It's the same trick. We're human. We're human, folks. It's psychology 101. But it works. So we search, we share, and we involve. It's only when we involve what we understand. And so when we get involved, that's when we physically understand. Here's how I deconstruct, and by the way, here's how I reconstruct it so that I build more prosperity and endurance in my program, and so I can be more resilient. I have only so many resources. And so, you know, that's the basic premise. The construct, how it's going to work, is I'm asking three general questions that are optional of people who sign up. And I know it's a significant price point, and I'm doing that for a reason. It's information. Price is information. And I'm giving a lot of myself. I'm giving you 20 plus years of experience. Yes. So I'm asking you these questions because I'm going to use the questions to create three case studies that are going to be composites of the challenges and the experience that you desire to have. And I'm asking the questions in a way where I bubble up also the serendipity piece, because you need to have that in the community. So we're going to do some planning and some serendipity. And then we're going to use... So the conversation is going to be about doing the work together, and everybody in a safe environment takes through some examples. There is no right answers. There is answers that work and answers that have not been tested yet. So I'm the first one to fail a lot. I use my blog to fail publicly, and that's okay. Because you know what? Nobody's going to keep score. We're going to be very much made in Italy in there. The program is in a church, so I get to preach to the choir. Because I know everybody's so smart by now. And I have plenty of jokes. Plenty of church jokes. There may be some singing. I'm not saying. So...
That is wild.
And so, but we're going to have Frank Eliason. He's, to me, he is the man when it comes to genuine interest in serving customers. He is the man. And the week after the program is actually, his book is live, is official, at your service. So it is my immense privilege to have him as part of the program, because I learn constantly every time I talk to him. And so he will, and I believe that will appeal to any size organization, mm-hmm. kind of understanding the customer service angle, because it's going to be increasingly crucial. People are just going to go to social networks first. It's not because they don't want to call the 800 number. It's because that's what they use. Mm-hmm. And so organizations are already starting operationally to think that through, and there is a lot of community managers out there monitoring and listening. And this is about the doing part of listening. How do we do the listening? And so that will be great. And then we're going to have Will Reynolds, who's also our host for the venue.
They're all my favorites.
Who will talk about, I mean, Will is, the man loves his employees, he loves his company, he loves his job, he has a passion for search engine optimization, and he's a great teacher and storyteller. And so I asked him to, and the format is basically giving people something to react to, so having prepared, kind of laying the groundwork, and then having a conversation about it. And so he's going to talk about content and SEO, and we all know content is important. Mm-hmm. It's your online style and body language. And then we're going to have Robert J. Moore, who is the CEO of RJ Metrics, mm-hmm. who got talked up by fab.com, and that's how I learned about them. And I went and looked, they're in Philadelphia, he's mine. And so I reached out to him, and I said, listen, I know you're busy, your time is valuable, you're an entrepreneur, and I've looked at your stuff, I looked at people who talked about you, and we need to have a piece on, and it's really not about metrics. The whole day is about how do I use what I know, because you guys know more than you think you know, and you're just not using it. And so my job is to help you bring it out and put it on the table and say, all right, we're just going to use, you know, the cans in the pantry. We're going to use everything we've got, and we're going to make this amazing ragù di carne. And we're just going to go home, and we're going to be energized and inspired. And if that wasn't enough, I'm giving away, only to the program attendees, I'm giving it away, a content strategy guide for brands, how to build an audience, convert buyers into customers, and enroll advocates. It's going to be very interactive. It's going to be more one-on-one than the rest of the program. The rest of the program, I have done enough of these that I can kind of improv a little bit to see the to gauge the level once I have people in the room, and that's why I'm also asking the question. And all of us, really, I mean, these folks have sold out venues. So I was so lucky to get them for my workshop. I cannot tell you. But you guys are the main course, so I need people to sign up and come on in, because without you, there is no program.
Exactly. I'm going to have to grab the links and the dates, et cetera, for that and post that.
It's April 19th in Philadelphia at the Search Church.
We're
going to get religion on social, man.
I totally love it.
Yes.
Oh, I love it. Yes. Well,
I'm going to bake too. I'm going to bake. I'm going to bring my own bake stuff.
Really? You're going to bake at the Search Church?
I am going to totally be a community builder. Totally.
That is amazing. Well, I'm going to have to – I have a lot of you and I travel in the same circles – or opposite sides of the same circles anyhow, where some of our acquaintances cross over. So, but I'm in the Philadelphia metro area too, so I'm going to have to get that and start.
Yeah, there. I need to, I was like, whoa, dude, I mean, you need to promote this thing. So I was I was looking at networks and things, and of course I went out to my list, and I've had people from all over already ask about hotels in the area, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So I'm getting all that information together as well.
Very good, very good. Well, yes, I will definitely have to go steal all that info from your site and pass it around as well, too. You've been totally amazing. I can't even thank you enough for jumping in. You are gracious. You are professional. You're knowledgeable. I was like, help.
Stop, because I can't trade my ego, see? So that's one of the untradeables. you can't trade that. I my shortcut is hope and hype. You can't trade those. Everything else you can trade.
Everything else you can trade. Too funny. Well, I've been in not that specific, not your industry for that long. I've been on the tech side for 23 years. And with little dips in and out here and there, because no one can stay in the same career or industry for over two decades and stay sane.
Yes.
It's just not possible. But our online lives view each other or intersect in some capacity, because I know I've seen you at conferences and we're in the same regional metro area, Philadelphia kind of thing. So... And I think we actually met in person for the first time at a friend's dinner or something, which wasn't a work type thing, which was totally social and totally organic.
Yes.
It was. But, I'm glad that it all came about, and I'm so, so thankful that you were able to jump on with us tonight and talk. And this, due to the magic of the internet and YouTube, this will in a day or two be up online.
Awesome.
So even more people can just hear and see the amazing information that you are so gracious enough to share with us tonight.
Like, yeah, and if people have questions, always happy to, come back to the recording and catch up with people, and definitely.
Exactly. And for anyone watching this live, if you've seen any of the shows that I've done, and I just realized in the last week or two that these are actually shows.
They are shows. Yeah,
they are shows. I put them online on YouTube in a day or two because I cleaned them up slightly, and all of the information, all the links that we talked about, the blog, the workshop, all of that, I will link to all of it both on womenofgplus.com and on the YouTube channel.
That's awesome.
Because search engines love all that, and I've got that part pretty much worked out.
It's the Google part of Plus.
It's the Google part of Plus that we want to feed. So we will feed it well with all of this information. So thank you again very much. We're going to end this hangout, and then we are not going to be able to see each other online or on the computer anymore. But like I said again, thank you so much, and thank you everyone for watching tonight or in the future, whenever you watch this. And be sure to get in touch with Valeria and let her know what you think, and sign up for her workshop if you are in that position. Fly in if you have to. Philadelphia is very nice. I go there all the time.
Yeah, it's easy. It's an easy. There's a train directly from the airport. Yeah.
Yeah, it's easy peasy to get into town. I'm crazy enough to actually drive into Philly, where in Manhattan I have to take.
Yeah, if you drive, not so much, but from the airport by train is.
It's easy, and we're in a international airport, so anybody else is, you know, from around the globe is more than welcome to come, and hopefully I'll be able to get there too. So we'll see.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Ciao, everyone.
Bye. Have a great night.